Thank you so much for joining. Be sure to invite your friends, let them know that we're live right now. Share this out, because tonight we have a very, very special discussion. We have a cultural storytelling with the Grand Traverse Band of Ottawa and Chippewa Indians. And I'm very excited to announce that we have Ton Showman, we have Hank Bailey, and Chris Ingram with us tonight. And Tom, why don't you introduce yourself and let people know a little bit about who you are and what you do.
Okay, I'll just say bonjour. My name's Tom Showman. I'm a councilman for the Grand Traverse Band of Ottawa and Chippewa Indians. I'm here with my grandson, Patrick, and I'll be 56 next week, and really looking forward to sharing a little bit about myself, but I'll let my colleagues introduce themselves first, and then we'll continue.
Bonjour, I'm Hank Bailey. I'm retired now. I'm an elder with the Grand Traverse Band. I'm Odawa, Muckaday, Mayingan, and Dotem, Black Wolf Clan, and I finished out my career in the Natural Resources Department, so I'm very involved in the environment and grew up in this region.
Abojo, Bidwewe, Benes, Indijnakas, Wabajeshi, and Dodam, Migazi, Odenang, and Donjaba, Ojibwe, Minawa, Odawa, Koyandao, Indoshiki, Madeo. I am Grail. I am the Grand Traverse Band Director, supported by EPA grant funding. I've worked for the tribe for about 12 years. I've been in the environmental field since I graduated from Grand Valley State University. And we're just here to have a discussion on our cultural views and personal backgrounds.
Absolutely, and thank you so much. We really appreciate you being here tonight and doing this. I think the first question I'd like to ask is, can you tell us a little bit about what it was like growing up as an Indian in a Western civilization?
I think we'll let our elder go first, so if he wants to speak on that, and then we'll just take turns.
Okay, I'll start out by saying I grew up from where we're at here. We're in Sutton's Bay, Michigan, and I grew up down in Benzie County, which is probably 35, 40 miles southwest of here, and it was a great place to grow up, actually. I grew up right on a lake. It was very quiet in the wintertime and a lot of tourists in the summertime. But, I experienced a lot in my lifetime as a young person, because I grew up in a time when there were no programs out to help people that didn't have a lot of money. And as Native people, it was hard for people to find jobs. And my father, I come from a family of eight of us in the home, and so hunting became a very important part of my life, because that brought in a lot of meat and protein for the meals. So that was a kind of a fun part and important part of growing up. I can go into more later, but
I grew up close to there, Benzie County in Frankfort, and I graduated from Frankfort High School, and I went on to Grand Valley State University near Grand Rapids, got an internship, got a job at an environmental consulting firm, worked there for 11 years, gained a lot of information in the environmental field, varying on a grand range of things, and circumstances came to a point after about 11 years that I was able to move back to the area and reconnect with my original dream, was to work for my people at the Grand Traverse Band, and I've been here ever since. My parents grew up at about the time Hank, they're about similar in age. stories from my mom were when she was little, she had a big family, and they were very grateful to be mistaken for Mexicans because Mexicans were treated better than natives. And a lot of times the girls would pull their knee socks up so high, to up past their knees, to try to cover their brown skin that their toes would hurt. And it was not a safe time. My great-grandfather spoke only the language, but he refused to teach the children or his children the language, the culture. So there were a couple of generations who were protected and were never taught anything. I grew up not knowing anything, and it took my own efforts as a 30-something-year-old to discover that we still had a Native community out there practicing traditionally, and I needed to travel as far as over the border of Michigan to Wisconsin to participate in those ceremonies, and I finally found a place where I felt at home, because I grew up feeling alone and different and proud with no basis behind it, and it was nice to finally feel that I was never alone.
I'll just say my experience was very different. My father's name is Paul Showman. My mother's Barbara Showman. My mom has since passed. And my dad was born in Cross Village. That's where our family came from. Back to, we can trace it back to the late 1700s when first missionaries came to that area, and all the generations from there. My father had to leave the area to get work, you know, and so he went to Flint, Michigan, famous for their pure water, and was a tool and die man for General Motors. And so, you know, I was in Class A high school for a while, and really I was the only person there identified myself as Native other than my younger sister. My father came from a big family. Him and his eight brothers all joined the Army and served. My father's 83 now, and he lives with me, and, you know, really sacrificed a lot for me. Again, I was in an urban atmosphere, lived in the inner city, but we had a summer cottage like in Cross Village, my dad's hometown, which was a just an old mobile home that he had with an outhouse and no running water, but it was a great way to grow up as a kid. And very, very rural area, just a tiny little village with a low gas station and a country party store type, and one restaurant, and a lot of times playing in the woods, riding my bike, and running through the woods. You know, the woods were my playground, and it was so different from the urban atmosphere. And there were a lot of Native kids in Cross Village, and I really felt at home. And I owe a lot to my parents, because my father sacrificed by working all the time, and my mother stayed at home and kept us in contact with my grandmother, Angeline Showman, who carried a lot of the traditions, and, you know, made medicine bags for us. Taught us how to, you know, gather medicines, spoke the language, and really had a lot of good teachings for us. So it was like living in two worlds, you know. And when I was in Flint, I think a lot of, I was viewed as an oddity, I would say, is the way I felt about it. Even my teachers, I think the general consensus was they felt like Indians, Native people were past tense. And there was no local history. They, you know, no one knew that, you know, about the three fires, about the Odawa, Ojibwe, and Ottawa people and our history. My parents taught me those things. We powwowed a lot. In the urban setting, I was just a novelty. Oh, you're not really Indian, or because of my fair skin, I'm half. But I think when they realized I was, you know, some people were very curious about it, but some people just couldn't accept it and thought of it as an oddity. I was very fortunate. Again, you know, my parents made me feel like it was something special to be Odawa. And so that's how I felt about it. You know, I felt it was something special, gave me a unique closeness to the land here. You know, I started sweating went to a spicer sweat when I was just a kid, and you know, they introduced me to a lot of good ways. Very just so grateful to that, you know, and the diversity of living in two worlds was hard for me when I first to fully let go of the city life, you know, to be selfish, to be thinking of yourself first and not thinking of your community, to I'm going to get mine, what's mine is mine, don't take mine, to more of a, you know, a tribal way. I've lived in my same house for 22 years. I've never locked it. And, you know, I have some people living with me who need a little help now and then. And, I you know, to just get out of that thinking of, no, it's not about me. It's about our community. And helping everybody, you know. So, and it's been a great journey, you know. And I never would have believed that it would take me all the places that it has. You know, my grandson here was born in Australia, and I went there to help his mom when he was a infant, and you know, I'm very grateful that they're home now. And he'll be raised here and learn these ways, but also be proud of who his other side is, you know. And he'll be proud and learn to speak Portuguese also. And you know, we are who we are. And I never would have believed this, you know. When we used to come up here and visit our family a lot. But there was no Grand Traverse Band of Ottawa and Chippewa Indians at that time in a formal sense. There was a community of Native people, and people knew who we were, and it was a good place to come and visit and play with my cousins. But it was dirt poor, and you know, we had to go home, and so my dad could work, it was different. And so I'm very grateful to the tribe and, you know, some of my elders that have laid the groundwork for me to serve on the tribal council and do my best to lift our tribe up. So it's a little bit about me, and I'll turn it over to Mr. Bailey.
I can go back into my history a little bit. I was thinking about what you said about tracing your family back, and same with me. I can trace my family back quite easily to the Treaty of Washington, 1836, when we were forced into ceding our land here in Michigan. So I always find that interesting a lot because it seems so funny that the people that came to this land were always so willing to give up who they were, and seem like they're still that way and want other people when they come here to give up their ways and be just an American. Well, you know, I've seen so many things change in my lifetime that, you know, sometimes all those things make me wonder. I've came to the point in my life because, you know, I heard Tom talk about the times before we were Grand Traverse Band. You know, I'm a person that, as some of you can all relate to, where you were at what age. You know, it's kind of, it was strange for me to walk through most of my a good share of my life. I'm 66 years old, almost 67. And anyhow, I never became what was known as an Indian in the eyes of the federal government until I was 30 years old. That was kind of weird when I would meet other tribal people from around the country and they'd say, who are you? And I'd tell them who I was and where's your reservation? You know, it seems like everybody had reservations. And, well, we don't have a reservation and we're not recognized as a people. Or it was kind of a, to me, a letdown feeling all the time because I could see it in their eyes. These other ones would look at me almost like, are you a real, you know, are you BSing about being a native or what? And so that was always kind of strange. So it wasn't until 1980 that we were the first tribe in the country to be federally recognized under our new federal recognition policies. And so to me that was a great thing, and I think it's something that needs to be talked about more amongst our young people in the tribe, just how great it is to be actually born into a recognized tribe, because it gives you a great sense of who you are and a community sense and many of those things. So I think it needs to be discussed more amongst our people, that how great a thing it truly is.
I agree, because I think a lot of
it's almost like a lost feeling for right. All those years, like you're just wandering, lost.
Well, I was born in 70. I mean, you know, a lot of times you get the impression that, you know, our people, and whether our tribe or our relatives out west in other parts of the United States, in Central, South America, their bones, their ceremonial artifacts, their regalia are in museums. And how do you explain to your kids why those are there? It gives you the impression that we're a people no longer. We're extinct like the dinosaur. And my kids experience that in school. I experienced that in school. And I was born in 70 in a very small community, raised Catholic, because for two generations, my family protected their children. And my great great uncles and aunts, some of them were taken away to boarding schools, taken from their homes, some were hidden. You know, I know my great great uncles told me that they would never reveal what atrocities happened to them during that time. They couldn't even put words to them, and they ended up taking those to their grave. And, you know, we're still here. We're still, you know, we have Columbus Day celebrated in this company. So we have mascots named after our people, which are a far cry from a respectful gesture. You know, when you've got people in the audience war whooping and making caricature gestures. And like I said, I was born in 70, and
Patrick,
in a small community. I remember my mom and I go into the store, and we'd see a Native woman, and my mom would be real careful, and we would, when no one's looking, we'd make eye contact with her real quick, do a quick nod, and I was so excited to see someone who looked like us, But I wasn't allowed to say anything. I wasn't allowed to hug her, say hi, have a conversation. All I was allowed to do was give a quick nod and move along, because you didn't want to draw attention to yourself, because you were not an accepted race in the community. And if you were mistaken for white, that's good, you know, and you just kind of, it was a self-protection kind of thing. And, you know, for whatever reason, I grew up with this fierce pride in myself, and which didn't help me fitting in with non-Native communities. And I am sorry for those who, my school children who decided to give me war whoops and make fun of me. I didn't take it well. But, you know, your children, you don't have perspective. You just have, you do your best. And it wasn't until I came back to the tribe after having graduated college, the Grand Traverse Band of Ottawa and Chippewa Indians honored me with this eagle feather, which I've had ever since. I take it with me everywhere, and I am so proud of it. And even more proud to have come back to my community, to serve in my community. And, you know, when you do that, you know, you're told your whole life, go out, get an education, the tribe supports education, you go do that. And when you finally find your way back, sometimes you're met with some jealousy in the community that, you know, oh, who are you to have an education? Who are you to get the better paying jobs? You know, so it's real hard to live in two worlds. You know, you need to live in two worlds to get that job, to get that career, to get that experience. And then when you come back, it's not always easy either. And also, growing up, not being as dark-skinned as others, it sometimes is easier because you're not automatically recognized as Native, which I am Ojibwe and Odawa. But yet, it also allows you to hear things that you wouldn't normally hear. And sometimes that hurts on the inside. And then you have to decide, do I make myself stand out? Do I say something? Is it worth it? Or do I just keep going? So, you know, living in two worlds is not always easy. And then I have four kids. So now I'm raising them. And I'm trying to decide how to explain to them these same things I've tried to figure out, and I still don't know if I know the right answers. I take them to lodge. I try to help them to understand the two worlds and how to live in both. So it never seems to be easy.
Do you remember a specific example from growing up where that was like, can you paint the picture for people who, so they really understand what it was like, maybe, if you can remember something specifically?
Seventh grade, history class. There were about three sentences in the history book, and they actually used the word savages and talked about how the savages attacked and were annihilated. You know, I sat there in a room full of my friends, looking around the room, looking for someone to be appalled or upset or shocked, and nobody was. I brought it up to my teacher, and, you know, this is a long time ago, you know, and I got blown off, and I was terribly upset. But as a child, you don't have that knowledge to take it forward to someone who would listen. You know, you just gotta walk around knowing that you just got you, your family, your relatives, people you love, people you know, were just referred to savages and maybe a people who no longer exist. And it's real hard to figure out as a kid. And with two generations who were isolated from the culture in my family, there really wasn't anybody to go to. So you just kind of figure it out for yourself. Sometimes I fought. Sometimes I was upset. Sometimes I wrote about it. You know, you're just, it always felt like there were only a few people in the community that were Native, and we were always trying to keep our heads down. It wasn't like we could get together and talk about it and feel better, because we all seemed to be hiding, laying low, not drawing attention. And we all tended to be, to have less money. You know, we weren't the rich, popular kids, so we already had a hard time fitting in. So you just don't want to draw negativity to yourself. And, a lot of times I got very upset and took it out in anger. But, you're just a kid. You don't know what else to do. Until you go out into the world, you go to college, you put some perspective to it, and you are able to verbalize how you feel and to figure out that it's not right, it's not acceptable, and then make some educated decisions on what you want to do.
Yeah.
Find your voice.
I think, it's funny, I hear on these stories, because we don't talk about this kind of stuff very much. And for me, it was very different. When you said, what's a specific example? I remember I was in the fourth or fifth grade, and there was a book, and it was about this little Irish guy, and everything was stereotypical, and Thomas O'Toole or something, and he came down and he showed all these dumb Indians how to do everything, and it had these little, I'll never forget, because they had this Indian and they said, how did you come up with the word tomahawk? Because he made one and he threw it and he hit a hawk and killed it, and it came down and Thomas O'Leary said, or the Indian said, look, tomahawk, and he killed it, and then that's how they named it. And and I was like, and I remember I took that book home and I showed my mom, and my mom was not Native, but she was a fierce woman. And she went to the school the next day and she said, this is unacceptable. And we had a discussion about it in school and said, this was a terrible book. And, my mom got, was able to look at different books that from a Native perspective that they would, she would look at from that point on. And, that taught me to be a fighter about, I went way out of my way to show everybody I was Indian. I had long hair, they used to have these bumper stickers, Indian and Proud, and I put that on the back of my my coat, and I had a bone choker I wore all the time, and I really, really went out of my way to say, I'm different. I'm different than everybody here. I'm the only one. And it really helped me, but I think it helped me because, we did go to ceremonials, we did go to powwows, we were around Indian people a lot, and, there was a lot of alcoholism in, with Native people, but my dad didn't drink, so I was always proud of that, and he always helped everybody, all my aunts and uncles and cousins would come live with us and stay with us, and, I was always proud of that. I took that pride and showed it like that. And, I've talked a little bit of, some people about, the other side of that. I lived in the city. There was always, you have your identity crisis. I always tell people I almost suffocated when I was in high school because my head was so far up my, but I was always trying to prove something, being a short, skinny Indian boy in the city, I was just always trying to prove something, but once I found my way back to the tribe, it really set forth a real nice path for me and my children. My children are all doing well. My grandchildren are doing well. You know, very fortunate. Got 10 grandchildren, and they're good, loving people. And that's, you know, those are the values that were carried down within my family. And that's what's most important to me. They're respectful of Mother Earth, of other people, of other creatures. And, you know, because those are all our relations. And so, those are the core values, you know. And I'm so, again, you know, I say this all the time. I'm just so grateful to my mother and father for giving me all that. You know, I try to honor them all the time by telling their story, what they did, the sacrifices they made to make my life very easy, you know. So I'm the only one that made it hard for myself, really.
Yeah, it's interesting to notice the difference between your stories. And then what about yourself, Hank?
Well, so many of the stories they're saying trigger a lot of memories within myself, you know, about growing up and experiencing a lot of different things. Sometimes a prejudice in a obvious way, and other times prejudice in a that you know it's there. But you know, I would see it a lot of times where I grew up, because my grandfather was well respected. He was able to hang on to 80 acres of land. He raised 12 children on those 12 acres and never had a car, and did it by using draft horses. He was successful and well respected by all the community people, the old farmers around. You know, he was just one of them. So our name was a good name in the area, which helped us. But I also understood where it was, because I would hear people saying things about Indians, or they, you know, right in front of me, they'd say something, and it was like I was invisible. But then they'd also notice me, "Oh, all right, because you're a Bailey," you know, that kind of thing. And you guys are all right, you know. Well, how does that make you feel when you know? You probably walk away, and then maybe you're not. I saw a lot of things. I heard you talk about history. I can remember the history books. It was like pages. There's Indian history. I think it was, from what I can remember, was really about one page, and it showed a Sioux Indian on a horse, and that was basically it. And so there was never any kind of connection in school, and within our language stopped within one generation, and that's when the boarding school experience came. My grandparents on my mother's side, grandparents on my father's side, all were fluent speakers, and when the Catholic Church came in and took my father's and sisters and them to the boarding schools, well, my grandmother became a very devout Catholic at that point, so she would actually hold meetings right at my grandpa's house. But they were so influenced by it that it turned out they felt it was right not to speak the language to the children or grandchildren, so the language stopped. And I can remember us kids running around the house, elders were sitting around talking, and everybody was speaking fluent Anishinaabe Mohen. And if we asked what to talk about, because they'd be laughing, they would always say, "Well, if we told you in English, it just wouldn't be funny." And mm-hmm. So that was kind of the answer we got. But you know, in there, and that's how they understood how to survive, because it was a real hard time for them. And as young people, we didn't understand what they were going through to try to survive. And there was a lot of that happening. And when you ask about some specifics, I could think of one time personally when it was probably in 1963, I was really starting to feel that I wanted to let my hair grow, and so I started letting my hair grow, and that it was probably, oh no, it must have been 65, because I was walking down the street in Beulah in the summertime, wasn't even school, and all of a sudden my basketball coach, I happened to be been a pretty good athlete, and I made a name for myself on the basketball team, and the basketball coach and the football coach pulled up to me on the street and told me to jump in the car, you know, so they're my teachers and coaches, and where are we going? I don't know. Jump in. And so I got in the car, and they took me up to one of their houses, and what they did is set me on a chair in the kitchen, and one of them, the football coach, went in and got a shaver and came out, and they shaved my head, cut all my hair off. He told me, you're not going to play on my team looking like that, and that was the answer I got. So that's how I ended up with my senior picture. You know, I wanted long hair. My senior picture, I had short hair because those guys had cut my hair off. So those are some of the things that I was forced to do. And in my lifetime, I was always into the woods, always walking. I could go anywhere, and I can even remember the very first time I saw a no trespassing sign. I thought, what is that? And I read it, and I was looking at it, and I thought, is that real? Does that really mean I can't go in there? I stood there for a long time studying that sign, and suddenly that had become a fad, and everywhere you went, when you used to be able to walk anywhere, suddenly you couldn't go anywhere because it become mine. That's what I always say when I see those no trespass, and somebody say, that's mine. That was just one of the instances of getting, you know, actually getting my hair shaved off as a young person, you know, growing up, not being recognized by the federal government, even though, you know, I traced my lineage clear back to Kamusa of the Treaty of Washington in 1836. So, you know, it's been a strange journey for our people in the state, and how we've been able to stay here and survive is the real amazing thing when I look back at it. So, you know, still have many struggles here, tons of struggles as our community. We have infrastructure that allows us to come back and become a community again, but, you know, when everybody's been living outside our community, and now you come back, and our clan system has broke down a lot, and so we're, you know, we're struggling to become a good, strong community again, but the reality of it is we are getting stronger all the time. You know, we had one of our elders in the old days, he was a Spanish-American War veteran, in the days when the Eagles were disappearing, we call them the McGeezy, and the McGeezy were disappearing. The elder, his name was Jonas Shaman Daisy, was sitting around with the elders, and they were talking about how bad times were for no food, no work. What were they doing? And the Eagles were disappearing, so it looked pretty bleak at time, and Jonas Shaman Daisy told the other elders, he said, when the Eagle returns, he said, we'll be a strong people again. Well, through the way things have changed with how the Eagles are treated, they are coming back again, and kind of when he said that, it's true, because we are becoming a strong people again. So for us, that statement is, you know, I think about it a lot, and helps me to drive to try to keep doing good things within my community to make us stronger.
Yeah, absolutely. And I remember when we spoke the other day, and I don't know if this is the right time to take it there or not, but you spoke about something called the Trail of Death, and many people out there know about the Trail of Tears, but you mentioned the Trail of Death, and I wondered if you could talk a little bit about the real history.
Well, this is a history as far as what how I know it, and the to me it. One of the my cousin will argue with me and say it goes back a bit farther to where the stronger part of our history. But for me, it always goes back to 1830 when President Jackson signed the Indian Removal Act. And that Indian Removal Act basically said that all Indians east of the Mississippi River were to be removed out to Indian country. So that meant taking them out to desolate land that they thought was no good and putting them there, and they called it Indian country because there was tribes there already. And so everybody knows about the Trail of Tears, where the Choctaw and the Cherokee were removed from down in the southern part and marched out into Oklahoma Territory that way, what was called Indian country. Well, nobody ever talked about the trail that came out of southern Michigan and went down through Indiana and straight out west, headed towards what was described as Indian country, even though Indians are here and they're taking us away from it. So anyhow, that trail, it was the same type of thing. Everybody was just walked and marched out, and if you couldn't keep up, you just were left there, died along the trail. So there was people. So the stories I was told, that was called the Trail of Death, that went out of our state. And so in 1830, they were removing our people from this area. And so we were running and hiding. We were crossing in. We have relatives in what is now Ontario and the Manitoulin Island chain up in there. Our people were hiding with our relatives up in Ontario and in the Manitoulins and crossing over at what is now Wapo Island and those areas, and by Port Huron, and hiding with people there, and then just hiding in the woods. So this went on for 6 years of this removal. And so you can imagine there had to be a lot of fear and just general terror going on within our people and not knowing what was going to happen. You can imagine how the Mexican people feel right now when they're, you know, I hear many stories of how when somebody knocks at the door there, you know, I kind of feel where they're coming from. And so for 6 years this was going on. Finally the federal government in the early days of what was a treaty era, they started the treaties. Well, ours was one of the early treaties in the country, and the federal government came and got to some of the well-known chiefs of the area and gathered them up, and they had a meet, and they just started discussing what to do, because the federal government understood in order to make this place into a legal state, they had to have a legal binding document with the indigenous people. So that's what they were striving for. And so in 1830, they, with our backs against the wall, our ogamas, our chiefs, signed that treaty, which gave away two-thirds of the land of what is now Michigan in acreage within that treaty. And, you know, I've been involved in some treaty negotiations when the state of Michigan is trying to take away our inland hunting and fishing rights. So I kind of understand the feeling of knowing when you got the government and all the high-priced attorneys and all the powerful organizations behind coming to try to take your rights away. I had a little sense of what those the chiefs and the people must have felt like, only it had to be way worse in those days. So, you know, to them, I think the real thing was they probably talked it over and said, hey, we can stay here at least. We know everybody's being hauled away. At least they say we can stay here. And it says we can hunt, fish, and gather yet. So if we can hunt, fish, and gather, and we're still home, let's do it. That's the best we got. So in my mind, that's kind of how it got to where they were backed into the corner bad enough that at least they could stay there, and if they could hunt, fish, and gather. And that's pretty much what we got out of the treaty. One other part was that it, within that treaty said that they would educate us, so that turned into be a great thing for us because we now have what is known as a Michigan tuition waiver, which allows our people to access college tuition here. So that part worked out good, but we never got really anything else. We never got our reservation. And it kind of irks me sometimes when I'll hear some non-Native people say, well, gee, if, you know, they don't have to pay taxes for this or that. You know, and I think, good golly, you know, maybe if we owned all the land in this county that was supposed to be our reservation, which would have almost been the whole peninsula, maybe we would have a little bit more money. Yeah. I can picture me living up on the side of one of those cliffs watching the sunset. So anyhow, that treaty was signed in 1836, and we survived, and we're still here. So, you know, to those guys, I think they did the best they could for where they were. And there's been a lot happened since then. You know what I've seen? If you don't mind me hogging some lots of time, because you know I can get talking, because I wanted to work this in before I forgot about it, was over time, people have always, because we all of us sitting here know exactly who we are. We know our families, you know, I'm Odawa, most, I think everybody knows their clans and all these things. But the non-Native people have always not known what to call us. There's so many different tribes. They want to lump us all into the same bunch. And so I guess in trying to be respectful, they come up with this name of, over time, at least in my lifetime, I was an Indian always, you know, to everybody else. I was an Indian. I got used to being called an Indian. And we all know how that being called an Indian is. I mean, we've been called an Indian like, you rotten Indian. The Indians, you know, we've been called all kinds of Indians, and I've been called Indian with a respectful way too. So we've understood how to accept being an Indian. But then over time, now suddenly it came that wasn't good enough for people. You know, they didn't feel comfortable with calling us Indians. So well, that's not right. We got to call them something better than that. So, since they were natives of this place, and this is America, we better call them Native Americans, because that's more real for them. So suddenly, hey, you guys, we're going to call you Native Americans, okay? We look around, well, okay, I guess they don't know we're Anishinaabe, but okay. So suddenly, all of a sudden, that's the thing. We're Native Americans all of a sudden. And I've had people come up to me many times. I'm a traditional dancer, and be at a powwow somewhere or whatever, and people coming up, and I usually be two people together, and I could always tell they had been discussing it, and they're being respectful, and they come up, and they want to get the right answer or do the right thing. And they'll come up, and they'll ask me, what would you rather be called? We were curious. Would you rather be called an Indian, or would you rather be called a Native American? And I will always give them the answer to that. Well, actually, you can call me a savage, because I was called a savage before I was an Indian or a Native American. And I kind of like the word savage better than an Indian or a Native American, because people don't seem to know that I'm Anishinaabe or Odawa. So if you got to call me something, call me a savage. But it seems like I need to be Native American. But the reason I'm bringing up this point is I have come to the point, because of the direction this country has taken and how Americans are looked upon when you leave this country and other countries, that, you know, I've came to the point that I don't want to ask, or I'm asking my friends not to call me Native American anymore. So if you need to call me something, You know, if you're speaking to somebody about me, please don't call me a Native American. I'd rather be called Indian or savage if you got to call me something, but don't call me a Native American. The reason I'm saying that is because it, to me, it's a dangerous label to put on me now. If I leave this country and I'm in some other country and somebody overhears me telling, who are you? I'm a Native American. American. Right away, I'm not kidding. That's how I feel. Right away, I feel like I'm in jeopardy by just the label that's been thrust on me as. So please don't call me a Native American. I'd rather be a savage.
I love that, Hank. So
there's where I am with that lineage of names that's been thrust on me.
Yeah, and I know we didn't get a chance to mention it, but we have been joined by Desmond Groh. He's the director of the Natural Resources Department, and he was behind the camera for a long time, but he also grew up partly in one culture, partly in another culture, so he has a lot to say as well. And I don't know where this is, where to take this, but one of the questions that's in my head is, you know, what are some of the things, I guess, that have been lost or you haven't been able to do as... tradition, some of your traditions, some of your spiritual traditions, your cultural traditions that have been either frowned upon or literally outlawed for years.
Well, before he gets started with that, I want to excuse myself. This guy's getting tired, and I know. I just wanted to say how grateful I am for you to be bringing these things forward, and it's nice to sit here with my friends and talk about these things with my grandson, and... you know, I think it's good to share these type of things, and you know, you can see the stories are very diverse. We're a very diverse people, and we like to tease a lot. You know, and I wanted to tease my uncle here a lot when he was starting to talk about the savages and stuff, but. I'll leave that for another day.
I'll get into it.
But, but you know, I think earlier when we spoke, you know, I really appreciate Kevin coming here and speaking with us and sharing our stories. And I think that's a good thing. And, you know, we got a lot to talk about. You know, there's a lot of vital issues with Native people. But most of them relate to us keeping our homeland safe, you know, with the water, especially. And so I'll leave it at that. And again, say Chimigwetch. Talk to you soon.
Chimigwetch.
Talk to you soon. Say bonjour. Shake his hand.
I'm a pee. I'm a pee. What a sweetie.
Come in.
Okay. Come on.
So,
that's great.
What you couldn't see behind camera was the lovely little grandson coming back to shake my hand too. It was beautiful. So, let's talk about maybe some of those things that have been either outlawed or kind of lost or frowned upon.
Well, let my dogs bark at Tom real quick. I'll say, you introduced yourself with our language, didn't you? So when the dogs quiet down, I'll say, Ani, Ajao Dewa, Nimki Banasi, Nindijnikas. Nimki Indorum, Minua Waga Shindorum. Manistik Indonjaba. So, I said hello, and then I introduced myself with my spirit name and my clan, Thunder Clan, and my family came from the fox side. And then I said I was born in Manistik. That's in the Upper Peninsula. So my story is a lot different than then my elder and one of my best friends on the planet, Chris.
Because that's a different world up there.
It's a lot different world. So I was born in 1974. That's actually 4 years before it became legal for Indians to practice their spirituality under the Freedom of Religion Act of 1978. So I was actually born 4 years before that. What are you doing, the math? Making sure? So, born in 74, my grandma was a full-blooded Odawa woman. She was born south of here, 4 or 5 hours, Sand Lake area, from Grand Rapids, a little north of there, I guess. Her father's name was Benjamin Sands. Hank might have even remembered Ben. Yeah. So that was my grandpa. Never had an opportunity to meet him. My grandmother's mother, so my great-grandma, took her from this area real early on while she was young, because that was about the time frame they were taking native kids and putting them into boarding schools. So my grandmother actually loaded up, my great-grandmother loaded her up and took her to the Upper Peninsula. They worked in lumber camps, logging camps. There was some fishing industry, but of course it wasn't recognized then. So I grew up always knowing I was Odawa. So my mom, she was a half Odawa, and that makes me a quarter Odawa, just enough to make the membership rolls here, which, and we can get into that later, but it's another form of wiping us out. But so I went to school and I grew up in Newberry, Michigan, the Upper Peninsula, and I went to school there. I guess I wouldn't say it was popular to be an Indian around there. But for me, you know, you look at me. I was able to blend in pretty good. I was in disguise. And pretty much spent a lot of time trying to be in disguise. The problem I had with that as a kid growing up is people knew who my grandma was, and she was full-blooded Otawa, and there was no being in disguise for her. So it was a little hard to run from it. I wanted to. I really did as a kid, because, you know, the name of my high school is was the Newberry Indians. A great big chief head painted on the side of the school and a gymnasium floor. There might be some couple watching right now from school as well. I actually wrote an article one point in time. Levi Rickard published it in, what is that, Indian Country Today, or I believe it is, something like that, about mascots. Because I'm dead set against them, and I'm dead set against them because when you're an Indian and you're going to school and you're in high school and your sports team is called the Newberry Indians, and they start playing the tomahawk chop and people are over here doing this in the stands, and the opposing team are saying stuff like scalp them, you know, you're hearing that, doesn't make you feel very proud. And they're sitting in the stands, the fans supporting the Newberry Indians are going on a big drum, and they're giving this Hollywood drum beat. It's not our beat. That's not at all. But you're getting this boom, 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 you know. And you got everybody doing it. So I'm sitting there. I grow up with that. I live with that. I learn, you know, I hear that. You know, and people are saying savage. You know, get the savages and
kill the Indians.
Yeah, it's like
war whoops.
Making the woo, that's what the fans are doing for the Indians, the Newberry Indians. So the problem I have with stuff like that is when you try to explain to somebody who doesn't come from, you know, my background or our background, I guess any Indigenous person really, try to explain to them, and they automatically come back with, well, we're trying to show you respect. We're trying to honor you. You know, how does this not honor you? Well, first and foremost, let me decide what honoring my ancestors look like. I'm not deciding for you, if you're of Irish descent, how to, you know, honor your ancestors. I'm not, if you're from German descent, whatever, I'm not telling you, you know, how to honor your ancestors. So don't tell me how to do it. You know, if you want to know, that's great. Love to share with you how to honor our ancestors, my ancestors, and what it means to me. But to tell me that because of a mascot, you know, well, we put this chief head on the floor. Oh, for God's sakes, with the war bonnet on and stuff. I'll let my elder talk about that, whether that's how we dressed or what we wore or anything like that. But, you know, that's not honoring for me. So my grandmother, she actually worked for the Department of Social Services, and they had a program for Native Americans. I'm not referring to Uncle Hank here. They didn't have a program for savages. It was for Native Americans. She was her job title was the Indian Outreach Coordinator, and that's what she did. There was 50 to 100 families around Luce County, which is in the Upper Peninsula area, that she worked with. And my grandmother, along with my grandfather, who's still alive today, he lives with me, which is very awesome, very cool. He's 87 years old. He's a World War II veteran. He's been to Korea. He's been in the Army. He's been in the Marine Corps. So he's something else. I'll just segue into this real quick. He also put Pipeline 5 in across the UP. He was on that crew running a dozer. So he's got some stories to share with us pretty soon about that. They started the first tribal center up in Newberry, Michigan, which was pretty cool. And I was like 10, 11 years old. Learned how to make my first pair of moccasins. Learned how to make black ash baskets. Learned how to make quill boxes. Learned how to do some bead work. Learned how to work a little bit with buckskin. Learned how to make a drum. I actually learned a couple powwow songs. We hosted a few mini powwows at the school in Newberry. It was kind of cool. So I couldn't hide any longer from being an Indian. And I didn't want to. You know, I wanted to be proud of that. But I say that cautiously because part of me wanted to hide. And part of me could hide. And I could hear the nasty comments. Even, I'm only 42 years old, guys. I'm not that old. And I've heard the nasty comments. I've heard the snickers in the background. The dirty Indian talk. I didn't necessarily get it the same way the way Hank received it, or maybe even Chris received it. I don't know, but we've all experienced it. Moved down here when I was 18 years old to my community here, the reservation. And I started commercial fishing. In 1997, I got hired for the tribe in the Natural Resources Department. I started educating myself. I started studying for college courses, doing online courses. I started taking as many trainings as I could possibly get in the tribe. It's been a blessing for me where that comes, because always constantly, you know, in our department, renewing our skills, going to different trainings, and I've been there for 20 years now. Been there for 20 years. I started out at the grunt position. I started out in 97. I was making $6 an hour as a fish and wildlife technician. But it got me off the lake from commercial fishing, which I had done the previous 5 years. And it was perfect timing because I got hired in November when we closed the fishery down for whitefish spawning anyway. So it's like it was perfect. And then somewhere in between there and 98-ish, I met my wife. And I had an instant family because my wife had 3 children. And so $6 an hour wasn't going to cut it. Well, it was another blessing in disguise. I'm meant to be where I am working for the tribe. The other blessing in disguise was the tribe had just contracted with an organization to come in and redo the wage grid. So I got a substantial raise. It was nice. They brought those wages in the position I was in up. A lot of different wages came up because they brought them up to a market level, which was fantastic. Now I could afford to support my family. So I remained there. And I moved up from there to a water quality specialist. And then I got a little frustrated because I didn't feel like I was making headway. I took a 16-month hiatus and I went and sold cars in Traverse City. I made a whole bunch of money. This was about 2003 or 4 when I did it, or no.
Later.
It was around 5 because I came back in 6. Mm-hmm. So it was around 04-ish, 05. My wife knows, we made like $96,000 in 10 months selling cars, and I wasn't happy. I was empty. I thought, awesome, I'm going to go make a lot of money. And I did, but I was empty. I was helping out tribal citizens a lot. I was running ads in the tribal newsletters, and I was working with our finance department, trying to get the best possible rates for tribal citizens, and working with the owner of the company to offer special discounts for tribal members just to come in and get a $50 gas card. Let's just get them in here. Let's see if we can help them with a vehicle. And so I was doing well. I was doing really good, but I had that hole. And in 2006, job came open for aquatic biologist. Chris hired me, brought me back into the department, which was great. Loved it. I'm home again. Kind of had to fight a little bit at the time, but we made it happen, and I got back into the department. And I didn't lose my seniority, which is great. So I didn't lose my seniority in terms of banking vacation time and stuff like that. And then at some point in time, Chris decided to do the same thing I did and go on a hiatus. She left, and I applied and got her job as the environmental director. And then Chris wanted to come back, and there was an aquatic biologist job, and she got that job. So we're back together. and now I'm the department manager, the director of natural resources. Well, in that last 10 years or so of my career, I had the pleasure of working with Hank. And I learned a lot from Hank. And some of the stuff that I learned about Hank, you heard just a little bit about the gym teacher, the coach, the basketball coach, I guess it was, picking him up and, hey, come on with us. And, of course, he's going to trust a trusted person like that. And he does, and then he gets his hair shaved and gets his head shaved. Hair cut off, and I, a lot of other stories. Hank and I spent a lot of time on the road going to different meetings and different tribal nations to work with different natural resource departments, and I've heard a lot of stories. And I guess for me, the big deal with Hank, we sat in a meeting one time, and a woman had been pushing Hank to ask these questions, and really upset me, and I told her to stop. And she was a non-native, she was a doctor. I didn't really tell her to stop, I just said, you can ask your own questions, it's an open meeting. Oh okay. A few minutes goes by and she starts prodding Hank, whispering in his ear, and Hank's a nice guy and he doesn't know who she is, so he's asking these questions. Maybe Hank thinks she doesn't have the courage to ask the question to the group, and maybe she didn't feel like she belonged there, and she didn't. I'll say that. Because finally I turned around and I just said, "Who are you?" You know, and she tells me her name, and I don't remember what it was, but she was a doctor. Big whoop. Then she followed it up with, "I'm just trying to help him ask the pertinent questions. I am trying to empower him." And right. I about lost it at that time.
Right,
know?
And so one, so really there's a lot of misunderstanding, and I guess between the Western world and between the, between the Indian world, there's a very different concept for elders. And how elders are treated and the value of them. But before we touch on that, I'd like to ask Chris, you know, there's some misconceptions that are out in the Western world of certain behaviors that are exhibited by Indians and how they're perceived by their own culture and then how they're perceived by Western culture. And they're two completely different things. So can you give some examples of how Indians are misperceived? Sorry.
There are a lot of differences. Sometimes when you're talking with a traditional person and, you know, they're talking to you and they look at you, they look away, you know, as they're speaking, and the non-native tends to think, you know, just maybe this person isn't being honest. They can't keep eye contact. They keep looking away. Maybe they're being dishonest, when in fact, traditionally, we do not maintain eye contact. It's not respectful, and we're told it can be spiritually damaging to expose your soul. You know, other races you've heard, the eyes are the doorway to the soul, and, you know, there's some similarity to that where you can be spiritually vulnerable by keeping gaze with a person. And so you see it a lot more with the elders and people who are more traditional. They'll look away, they'll keep coming back and talking to you, but it's not that they're not interested. It is not that they're being deceitful. It is a cultural difference of the way we speak. It's self-protective and it's respectful. There are other ways, such as in our lodge, everything in creation, there's balance. The creator is both considered male and female. In our lodge, we have a clan system where responsibilities are divided up by what clan you are. Males and females have different responsibilities, but they all work together to support each other. And so, you know, if you see the women standing up for the water, the men, they take care of the fire. That we have a distinct cultural structure that people don't understand. And, you know, women wear the long skirts, and I've heard people say, "Why are you told you have to wear a long skirt? Why do you have to wear a long skirt in ceremony?" Well, traditionally, the skirts used to be leather. They used to have fringe on the bottom, so they were even just a little longer. And I was told by an elder that women are to wear skirts as often as they can out of respect for their mother, because the long skirts caress our mother, they caress her back, and that's out of respect to our mother. And we do that to offer respect to her. You know, we don't do it for any other reason other than as a, you know, indigenous woman paying respect to our mother, the earth. And we believe everything has spirit. Everything has spirit. And, you know, that was part of some of the original criticisms of being savages. They talk to trees. They think trees have spirit. They think rocks have spirit. They think everything has spirit. They're, you know, there's only one God. Why would they worship everything? And it's not like that. We believe that all creation stories are true. There is only one creator. And that everybody's creation story is true. Every race of man's creation story is true. It is their journey from when they left their race, left the creator, to where they are today. That is their creation story, and it is true. The same with us. We have our own story. Now, whether that race has well preserved that story over the generations, that's on them. But our people have always believed in respect. We always respect all races. We believe all creation stories are true. That is a very big difference between the culture who came in here to assimilate our people into their own race. There was no respect to the point of atrocity. So those are just a few of the cultural differences.
Even pointing.
I mean, our people point with their lips, you know. You know, if we're talking over there, we use our lips. You know, there's just a lot of nuances.
Right, and you mentioned, you know, when another race came here and they pushed their beliefs and assimilated you into different beliefs. So what were some of those things that happened at that time, and what were some of those things that you lost?
We lost everything. Our children were, some were taken to boarding schools, some were just assimilated into schools, mostly by missionaries. They tried to make us look like them, speak like them, believe like them. They tried to take away everything that made us an individual people. They cut our hair. They beat us for speaking our language, including babies, little ones. They, put us on reservations so that they could control a small group, keep us in poverty, give us enough handouts just to get by. We've all heard of the smallpox blankets. At first on reservations, they used to give us cattle. And of course, our hunters would go out and they would hunt and gather those cattle. And they didn't like that. So instead, they started to give us killed cattle because they didn't want us to have any pride. And then we ended up with diseased cattle, you know. And it's a long history. You know, you've got the Indian Removal Act. It's in the law books to permanently eliminate these people. They've assigned a number to every indigenous person in the U.S. In a federally recognized tribe. We're the only race of people that I know of, besides maybe purebred dogs, that people are worried about what blood quantum they are. My children are at just over a quarter. If they have children with a non-native mate in life, their children will no longer be federally recognized tribal members. They will not be able to join the Grand Traverse Band because of federal law saying they must be at least quarter blood. So guess what? There is the end of the line in my family. And we're all that close. I mean, there's a lot of families that are close. And to me, my personal opinion, that was a very long planned, but eventually it may be successful way to eliminate all Native people, all tribes, all trust responsibility, all treaty rights, all tribal land, and to eliminate the problem. And most people don't even realize it. Our people don't generally realize it. General society may not realize it. And it may have already progressed too far to even stop. I don't know how to fix it. And it frightens me. Because my children, my grandchildren, unless they find a native mate, will no longer be federally recognized tribal members. And it's just, this is the same annihilation system that Hitler studied. So he watched how the U.S. government, in their assimilation process, he copied a lot of those things when he did the Jewish Holocaust. They also had numbers. He was a little more efficient at it. He tattooed it on their arm. You know, I joked around thinking that maybe I should put my number on my arm for symbolicism. But he did the same thing. He was trying to annihilate and eliminate a race. He just didn't want to take so long.
Yeah, it's really... it's really, really sad. And do you have anything to add with that?
Well, it makes me think of a lot of things, actually. You know, I'm a traditional dancer, and I get asked a lot of times to go speak with youth, and sometimes they want me to come in my dance regalia because, you know, it just looks impressive to the youth, and it gives them a lot of visual things to look at. And then, so when I'm explaining a lot of things about that, I run into things before that just kind of almost amaze me, but it shows me where the country is and how they look at us. You know, there was one time I was working with kids that were probably in third, fourth grade, or maybe even a little younger. Anyhow, three or four of the kids throughout all this time come up and had asked me, how come you're not dead? And as they asked me that, I blew it off, wondering, just thinking, I didn't answer it, and I'm just thinking, what do they mean? And finally, after about the third or fourth one, I kept thinking about it, and then it finally dawned on me what was really going on was these little kids were looking at me and seeing me in my dance regalia. So to them, I looked like Indian or savage from way a long time ago. And so they're looking at me standing there and they're wondering, how can this Indian be alive to this day when they're all gone? And that's pretty much what was going through those little kids' heads. You know? And it was kind of strange in knowing that, you know, maybe the next day they'd see me in the store in the line with them and wouldn't really realize. So that's kind of the mentality of the country, really, when you think about it, is all our stuff was, that was a long time ago, and we're, you know, we're just a part of history here. And, you know, we're struggling with that. And to me, what I'm starting to realize is we've been talking about these things throughout my grandfather's history from 1836, the Treaty of Washington. We've been explaining our positions and how we look at how we treat our Mother Earth, the water, and everything. And everybody listens to us, and they like to listen to us, but it's always just that Indian thing. That's what I'm learning. It's the Indians talking about their thing. And I think, personally, the real change in this country will come when the non-native people start standing up for us and not just saying it's their thing. You know, when non-natives will stand up to their friends and their buddies and say, what you're saying is wrong, you know, if they're talking about something that they know is untruth, and they have the strength within themselves to tell their friends, their family, that what you're saying is wrong and this is, we got to change it, that's where the real change in this country is going to come. It's never going to come from us. My generation, you know, my grandfathers talked about it. Now I'm older, I'm these guys' elder. I'm talking about it. Now I'm sitting with these young folks. They're talking about it. It just, people like to hear us talk about it, but nobody ever gets bold enough to actually step up and try to change things amongst their friends, because when when it's just us against the world, it'll always be that way, and it'll be just an Indian thing, and that's how it'll end up. And but we can't quit, us that are so tied to where we live, who we are, and we understand what's happening to our mother, what everybody likes to call Mother Earth. We know we can't give up, and so we continue when we're asked to come and try to help people understand. You know, we've been part of a project that involves the Maori people from New Zealand, the First Nations in Canada, and it's all revolves around water, because you know, the water is starting to become the gold of the world, and so that, you know, we've been talking about dam removal, restoration of the resources along the rivers and all that. Yeah. And somebody was talking about, you know, how is this all tied together? And, you know, boy, we sure miss you over there in New Zealand and stuff. And, you know, I it made me think that, you know, when you think about it, really the waters from our history carry the teachings and ceremonies of the past into the present and on into the future. So to me, when I miss my friends in New Zealand, I can go down and touch the water in Grand Traverse Bay down here and know that that water travels clear across the world. And when my friends are in New Zealand, they can touch the water, and we can be touching each other through the water that's connected through Mother Earth. So if we look at how we're all connected that way and how important that water can connect all of us and how it's necessary, maybe we'll, as human beings on this planet, start to understand how we can maybe step forward and tell our friends that, hey, you're wrong. We need to do some changes, you know, step up, be brave, and do it. You can't just keep looking away and say, oh, that's just how the Indians feel about it. Well, everybody knows how we've been feeling about it. We've been telling them, talking about it for a long time. And some of our stories tell that the non-native people will be coming to us and asking, and that's kind of where we feel we are. And that's why we take the time to try to explain where we've been and where we hope to go.
And keep explaining.
Yeah.
And I think we're really getting there, too. Yeah. The Standing Rock was really a eye-opener. You know, brought a lot of different people.
Oh, it's true. We see it in the organizations, I think, around that are popping up. But, you know, it was, for me, pretty sad, I guess, to think that the country, the way the election went, but maybe it's just I watched too much news or something, but I was pretty devastated, to be honest.
We've got a lot of things to overcome that have been, have kind of become custom in this country. Celebrating Columbus Day, at Halloween, watching people dress up in Indian costumes, and, you know, just there's a lot of things that people need to realize. They are not the mascots. They are not acceptable to our people. They're an insult. You know, having Columbus Day sales, and, you know, it's a constant reminder that they're not there yet. Or if they ask us to come talk to them and they're all excited about our regalia and they look at us and we seem mystical to them, or, you know, they talk about, you know, their relative might have been an Indian princess. Well, we didn't have Indian princesses, and they may mean well, but they're very misguided. And the things they don't see are the traditional things which are a part of our life. We go to ceremony. We have full moon ceremonies where we pray to our grandmother, the moon. We pray for the water. We pray for the community. We are constantly doing these things. They are not up for public display. They are not, you know, public events. They are who we are. You can't separate our language and our culture and our customs, they are all one. They are all connected. And we will continue to pray for all people, all people in creation. We pray for the water. We pray for the air. We will continue being who we are and fighting for our Mother, the Earth, and all in creation, peacefully, loving.
Yeah, you definitely have a lot to teach everybody. And hopefully some ears are open and some eyes are open and people are ready for those teachings, because many times you tried, and what's amazing to me is you haven't given up. You haven't said, all right, these people don't get it. We give up. We're just going to do our thing, protect ourselves. Please, Hank,
yeah,
please.
Yeah, well, just think about, when I hear that, it makes me think about, just think about the place where we're at, and the place that was our home. You know, we, man that came here, if he didn't know what he was doing, he just died. He didn't know how to survive. And we helped the newcomers to survive here. So, you know, in this place that we live, you had to be respectful to what you were able to obtain. And so we had learned to study everything and respect all the things that we understood provided us. And so we became strong and resourceful. And that's just in our genetics here, because if you were not resourceful and if you didn't hang in there when times were tough, you disappeared. So it's kind of in our makeup. And when, you know, we've all seen our parents and our grandparents struggle in times that we understand now that we are recognized Indians, that, you know, that gives us some advantages, because now we're a community and we have advantages of way greater things than we saw our parents have and our grandparents have, and even like myself as being a little older when I grew up in. And so, you know, it is changed, but it's just who we are. It's, you know, we wouldn't have been here maybe if we didn't have that in us. But, you know, I just understand who I am, and I know how my grandfather was, and then so I know how each one of those grandfathers came from the other ones, and they go all the way back to that man that was there fighting to keep us here. So, you know, that kind of strength coming from within you, knowing who you are, just gives you the ability to say, hey, I'm tougher than that. I can make it, and I'll still be here, and I want to be here for my grandchildren, and try to make this place a better place for them. You know, we came through a lot, and we're still going through a lot. And one of the things that I run into a lot, also, I'll throw that out while we're talking here, is being out into the public a lot, and people hear me, I'll have people come up and being very sincere to me, come up and say, oh, it was just awful what happened to your people a long time ago, you know. And I can see in their eyes and how they sound and everything, I know they're serious about how they feel about that. But the problem is, this country has so much apathy that nobody, when it comes to what's going on with us, nobody even knows nor cares about it. You know, nobody cared that we came into a new millennium in the year 2000, where here we change into a new century and a whole new millennium. Our country in the year 2000 is how many years old, this great American country? So in a new millennium, you think that this country would start wising up about how they treat people and everything. I don't really see much happening, because, you know, when somebody tells you, oh, it's awful what happened to your people a long time ago, well, in this new millennium, here comes the state of Michigan telling us that they have an attorney that found some wording in our treaty of 1836 that they feel discredits the inland portion of our treaty. So they were coming at us, telling us that we were no longer able to exercise our inland hunting, fishing, and gathering rights in a place that's always been our home. So here we are battling for, in the new millennium, things. Here we are back in court again. So, you know, as what my grandfather was in 1836, there, in a new millennium, there's one of his relatives there trying to hang on to the same kind of treaty that they said would be forever, you know. And when, so we had to negotiate and ended up with a consent decree, which, if you know anything about negotiations, we ended up signing a consent decree, which gave us some rights that they told us would now be forever, which they probably told my grandfather the same thing in 1836, that those things would be forever. So they even had the audacity to say it out loud. And so that's okay, you know, we'll just see. But it just shows you that, you know, that doesn't hold much water. When, and the fact is, when we were in court with all these, what we had organization after organization lining up behind the state of Michigan to take our treaty right with all their attorneys. And when I sat and looked behind us, there was five what's called tribes in Michigan that were part of that treaty. And they were the only ones that were fighting against the whole state and all these organizations and all the money and lawyers that they were throwing at us. We didn't have one individual, even a citizen of the state or the country, stepping up and telling the state of Michigan that you guys are wrong, this is wrong, that you're trying to take these rights from the people here because of some lame wording in there. So anyhow, we ended up in 2009 with a consent decree for our inland treaty rights that was signed supposedly forever. But within that, then we had to lose a little bit of right and supposedly kept some forever. But again, you know, doesn't hold a lot of water when somebody says it was terrible what happened to us a long time ago, because it's still happening, just not quite as out in the open and not as bloody as it was way back in the 1800s and those eras. Still there, though.
You know, I know some people have asked what they can do to help. So, people that are watching this and want to help, how can they help bring this together?
Wow. Never really had that. I've never been even asked that, have you? That's so wild now that I think about it. I've never had anybody ever ask, because, like I say, people wonder and they'll say it's awful. But I've never had anybody say, what can we do? It's like I said, when we were, it was amazing to me to see how many organizations and power that was lined up to, everybody was right there, no problem, take our right away, and nobody had a bad, nobody was gonna shed a tear in that whole crowd. And to look behind and know we had nobody behind us, that was pretty sad. And so, you know, we knew what we were up against. And I feel, you know, we worked as hard as we could to get the best we could, but, you know, it was, we had our backs against the wall again, as it always is. And so, I guess, I'm trying to think in my mind what I could tell somebody that wants to help, because there are good people out there, believe me. I've met so many good people, and there's a, in the area we're at, there's a lot of people that are really trying to make good changes. So I'm trying to be, think of something constructive that I could say. And I guess is to, you have to educate yourself about what is going on in your area. Because so much what I saw was these things were happening and people focus on the other things that affect their lives, and these things are just in, you know, there might be a little blip somewhere, wow, there's another Indian thing going on. So that's what I'm seeing. I don't know. I guess that's not that great of an answer, but I think really, to me, it's individuals talking with other individuals, and like I say, we've been talking about it forever, and that doesn't go anywhere. We just keep talking about it, So it's got to come from the non-native people to make the change. I really believe it's that, because there's so many, and they're the ones that's driving the country, making things happen. So until the non-native people get their head wrapped around about what has got to be done in the right way, change will not happen, and it'll just be the Indians still talking about the same old, and or the Native Americans. Call me a Native American in some country that hates Americans.
Well, you know, Chris, I think you mentioned something there that's really key, and you said educate yourselves. And I think one thing is, you know, if you've got children, they're not going to hear about this in school. So the parents can teach the real story at home. They can tell them and explain where they come from and where the true history of this country comes from. And maybe the big thing to change is to get that into the school curriculum, so no longer are they teaching biased, untrue history from a very one-sided standpoint. So maybe we need to get those kind of classes going into school.
I think that's a big answer right there. That's probably a huge part of it. If we could start, because it made me think that I've got a German friend that comes about every year to visit for a short time. He's a writer, and he comes, and he was coming to do a little piece in a magazine about Native people from here, and he was at a local town right close to us, and he was asking the people around there, where's a local reservation? And this town is 12 miles away from our reservation. And everybody was asking. Nobody knew where the reservation was. They didn't even know if there was a reservation. You know, he was astounded. So that's the kind of, I don't know if it's apathy or, more important things to, because nobody's really took time to give a care about us much other than if we had something they needed. But that's mostly all been gone, so we're just a piece of history.
It's going to take a lot of work on a lot of levels. The youth are a great place to start. I mean, when I lived on the reservation, I couldn't even get babysitters because their parents didn't want them coming onto the reservation. You know, so we've got multiple generations of opinions, you know, good, bad, ugly. You know, it's going to take time.
And that's one of the reasons that I talk with a lot, go to schools and talk with youth and try to help the young people think about diversity and how the world needs diversity in all forms, right on up to the human form. And so I just think, as far as people at home and their own self, I think educating themselves about their local communities and maybe the local native peoples of the region, so that, you know, they can teach their youth so they know what's going on. I don't know. I think that's pretty much been the problem anyhow, is when people don't understand something that makes them afraid, and fear is always what drives people to do bad things.
And fear keeps people from signing petitions to stop Line 5, to stop Nestle. I can put my name and my address on here. How's this going to affect me? Write a letter to the Smithsonian and ask them to please release the bones of our ancestors that they have in the basement that are just in storage, thousands and thousands and thousands of remains. like we're people who don't exist, like we're their dinosaur bones. I mean, nobody steps up to do much of anything unless it becomes popular, and then we get a little bit of time to try to catch that wave until it dies down again. I don't know what the answer is. Just try to put yourself in someone else's place. Try to put your child, the picture of your child, in someone else's place. You know, how would you like them judged based on color or hair length or, you know, I don't know. Sometimes it's talk that we need to give up on some generations because it's so ingrained, the hatred and the familiarity with that. Sometimes we have to go to the younger generations to just keep moving forward where we can. You know, we're not here to fight. We're not here to, you know, change the whole world. We're just trying to live and be happy and be respectful and be respected. That's all.
Yeah, well, Anishinaabe, the name itself, Anishinaabe, that, you know, that basically means the good people. So, you know, when I hear that in my life, I always look at that as, you know, why would we have ever called ourselves that unless we believed it, you know? And if you believe it, then that drives you to be that person. So
exactly.
That's you know, something that's been a driving force for me. And just thinking of, you know, I want to call myself Anishinaabe. Well, that puts some responsibility on you to be that Anishinaabe, that good person. So, you know, that's a great thing, and just the name itself. I've been kind of dying to explain. The public probably might not understand so much about this McGeezy feather. A lot of times what we do, and that's Chris had talked about, she always goes with her feather, and many of us will like to have a talking feather with us when we're talking because of our respect for the McGeezy, and we know that, you know, how we feel about the McGeezy. We've been told that if you've got this McGeezy feather on you or in your hand or something, when you're speaking, that's, you better be speaking the truth as you know it. So, you know, that's kind of one of the reasons I like to, if I'm doing some kind of talk or whatever, to have my McGeezy feather around to make me continually think of that and to try to tell the truth as I know it. And while I have this feather here, I'll explain that this is a immature bald eagle feather. And there, you can see these little cuts in there. And those are how those got in there, is this feather was found out in the woods. And when the eagles growing in a new feather, they start itching. And sometimes an eagle will reach over and that feather that's growing in, they want to get it out of there because it's itching. So they reach over and bite a hole in there, the feather that's itching. And they jerk on it, try to pull it out to get it out of there so it's not itching. And that's what this is. Hope I just took some more of it off. But that's what that is his beak. He's trying to get a hold of the stem of it so he could pull it out, but he missed it. And his beak is cutting off that piece there. So that's, you know, people that look at it and know what's going on, they can understand, oh, he was trying to pull his feather out. That's why that's cut like that. Just a little education on the McGeezy feather for anybody interested.
And then if someone's carrying a fan of feathers, then that's that. If there's some of the feathers actually that are snapped in the fan, then that means something different. Is that if someone is carrying an eagle fan that isn't taken care of very well?
That could be. Yeah, there are ways to take care of feathers. I mean, that's a possibility.
Yeah, but.
Because it's a highly, what I'm getting at is I've been told, it's a highly prized medicine.
Ceremonial item.
Yeah, and it's something that you take very, very good care of. And I mean, if you just show your feather, Chris, how long have you been carrying that?
since 1988. But
it's pristine.
And I also used it on my first fast. I fasted for two days for the people, where I ate and drank nothing for 2 days. And I asked for things for my community and prayed for them and all people in creation. And when we, like Hank said, when you hold this feather, it tends to, the spirit of the feather is, of the bald eagle or other eagle is in the feather, and that bird helps you speak the truth from your heart. And when people hold it, whether they realize it or not, it helps them tend to tell the truth. It makes it harder for them to be deceitful. And also in our traditional teachings, that bald eagle, there came a time when the indigenous people became very sick. They started to forget to follow their teachings. They started not to completely follow the clan system, and they started to get sick, and the Creator thought, well, maybe I need to start all over again. Things are just falling apart, and McGeezy told the Creator, whom we think we consider he and she, that McGeezy said, no, there are still people, our people are still following those traditions. Let me prove it to you. So he flew from creation as fast as he could, and night and day he flew as fast as he could, and the Creator says, well, if you're not here by a certain time, I'm going to start creation over. And he flew and he flew and he flew and he flew around the earth until he found this grandma and grandpa who had their grandchildren. And the grandma and the granddaughter were following the water teachings, and they were praying for the water that morning. The grandfather and the grandsons were lighting a fire, and they were doing the things they were supposed to. So then that bald eagle flew back as fast as he possibly could to the Creator and made it just in time to tell him that there are still people out there following our traditional teachings. And that stopped the Creator from starting creation over. And so whenever we see a bald eagle or golden eagle when we're doing something, it's a symbol that spirit is looking to see if we're following our ways. Are we using our tobacco to pray? Are we praying for the water? Are we taking care of the earth? Are the men taking care of the fire? Are the women taking care of the water? Are we doing what we're supposed to do, what we've been taught to do, using the gifts we've been given? So, you know, if there's a water walk and an eagle comes down and soars over, you know, that is validation that eagle is letting us know, I saw you doing your work, you know. So that's the significance of the eagle feather, sacred. When I got married, there were eagles came in and did a circle around the ceremony a few times and flew away. So it's very special confirmation.
That's really, really beautiful. And we certainly saw eagles when we were at Standing Rock numerous times. Exactly. The eagles came at Standing Rock.
And people were praying and doing things in a good way.
Yeah.
Same confirmation.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, in times of my life when I was young and struggling with my spirituality and who I was, and because it was at a time when you've heard Desmond talk, where a lot of times, you know, we felt it was hard to be an idiot. If you weren't, we just knew it would be easier. Mm-hmm. But yet we were always proud yet that we were, but yet you had that yin and yang going on almost every day of your life at some point. And but the eagle is such a strong part of all of that that, you know, I almost, as I was hearing that, it made me think of something. That's how I was starting to lead into this, and now my old brain went off, so I'm not sure where it's going. Sorry, folks.
I see you have another.
I could explain this too. This is a special. This is a ceremonial piece of the eagle that we use for ceremony, and this was given to me by what's known as a person with a bundle or a pipe carrier, and told me to make sure I used it. So I carry it with me a lot, you know, if it's something special or if I go into ceremony. And what this is a eagle bone whistle, and it's because the eagle bones are hollow to make them lighter. You know, this was made out of the part of the eagle wing, and then made into a whistle. And I've got an eagle plume on there, and this happens to, I got my clan colors, black and red on there, so I've got my clan colors on there also, and just what it is.
Beautiful. What about traditional types of music? Because I think one misconception that I've noticed is that flute music seems to be associated with all people who were originally here. And is that for the Anishinaabeg people? Is there a lot of flute music up here?
It's one of those things. I don't see a lot of them, but as far as I know, it's like you were saying, I think the flutes were pretty universal amongst people, weren't they? As far as I know.
But not as far as, you know, at least like in my lodge, there's no flute music. I mean, when we sing, those are our prayers. They're not just songs. We always, in lodge, speak in our original language. We don't speak in English. The only time we speak English is out of reaching back to our people who have forgotten our language. So the whole teaching is in the language, and then they apologize to creation and say, you know, I'm sorry, but we need to speak in that Shagnashi language, the non-native language, to those who've lost their language. And then they'll explain the general, you know, meaning of that. But for us, the songs are our prayers. You know, the eagle bone whistle is out of respect to that eagle spirit, calling to them, letting them know, you know, we're here, we're practicing our ways. We've got water drums and grandfather drums and... There are different powwows are different than ceremonial. They're for different purposes. So it depends on where you're talking.
Yeah, and hearing you speak, that's the feeling I get about the flute. Is it was probably more of
an entertainment
thing that, you know, maybe somebody would do to try to woo somebody that they were interested in or something. But as far as mostly ceremonies and stuff, there, you know, I never see the flute involved in the ceremonies.
I've never heard.
I think, you know, it was around, but it was more of an entertainment, pleasant sound. That's my feeling. But, you know, somebody may step up and say, you guys are way wrong. I don't know.
And again, you have to keep in mind, we are the Anishinaabeg people. We are the people of the Great Lakes Basin. We are the Ojibwe, the Odawa, and the Potawatomi, the people of the Great Lakes Basin. We are not out west tribes. We're not out east tribes. We are not, you know, we are talking about three specific tribes who used to be one people and have only been broken down by the government into small little tribes to isolate us into little groups. So we're not speaking for all indigenous people. We're not, you know, the only difference between the three tribes we were a confederacy. We worked together. We were essentially one people. Our languages are very, very similar. There's a lot of times there's just dialect differences because of different being in different areas. So we're only speaking from our own people in this area.
Yeah, for people listening, that might be a time to explain a little bit, because it gets confusing, and it probably even is confusing to some native people that don't know their history. Because if somebody is going to look at information, someone they're going to say, how many tribes are in Michigan? Well, they'll pull up some information. Holy smokes, there's 12 tribes in Michigan. 12 federally recognized tribes in Michigan. So, you know, us sitting here, we know that's not true. There's really three peoples here, three tribes, really. But in order for the federal government to keep us in our place, to know who we are, where we're at,
divide
and keep us right, and also in order, when we got federally recognized, we had our certain areas that we have federal recognition, and that's how it is. So that's what happened in Michigan, is the government took different parts, which were actually bands, like we're Grand Traverse Band, north of us, Little Traverse Bay Band, south, Little River Band, really the same people, but they made these bands of people into a tribe to be recognized by the federal government. So that means that's who you are, and you're right there. When in reality, we go down the Little River up north, up UP, all those people up there are our same people there. But
a lot of times they have relatives and people we know in all those areas.
Something I'd like to, just came to me, it's a little bit off the subject, but you know, what time I was thinking, because so many of these things are come to us in ceremony, and I was thinking one time, talking to a man that I respect and has what's called a poagon in our culture here. People, non-natives, usually refer to them as peace pipes, and here they're known as a poagon, and generally our people at carry that. They have all the things that they use within their ceremony when they bring out their poagon, and that all those things they keep them wrapped in, and generally is referred to as a bundle. Well, I was talking to this elder and pipe carrier, and I'd been thinking about all those bundles in the days when we were very persecuted and couldn't practice our ways. In those days, my grandmother actually used to take stones, heat them up in a fire outside, and put her stones into a bucket and take them upstairs. And she had a little sweat lodge upstairs that she would take her stones up and have her own little ceremony upstairs, because that's where she felt safe and able to do that at that time. So anyhow, I'm losing my train.
That was just part of being safe. I mean, it wasn't even safe for natives to gather in a group. You know, the sweat he's talking about would normally take place outside, but because of that time frame, you couldn't be visible. You couldn't do native things in public.
Oh,
so we kept our bundles hidden.
Oh yeah,
we
yeah.
met inside. His grandma did a sweat inside. We stayed safe. We stayed quiet. We had secret meetings. We buried bundles until it was safe to bring them forward again.
And that brought me back to what I was trying to think about here, was because I got to ask him. I said, you know, it was breaking my heart to think about all those bundles in those times when those people would take them and hide them out in the woods somewhere. They didn't have them around their house because they were afraid they'd get found and be in trouble or whatever, and they'd be destroyed, so they were hiding them. And then they were afraid to teach the teachings to somebody else too. And so suddenly these bundles would be out in the woods somewhere, and this elder that knew all those things would walk on, what we call walk on or die in the non-native culture. When they'd walk on, I was talking to them, I said, you know, it's breaking my heart to think of all those bundles and all those teachings that are gone now because these people were afraid to bring them out, and then they just finally got left in the woods and they walked on, and now that all those bundles are gone and the teachings are gone. I said, you know, I've been thinking about that, and it breaks my heart to think about that. He said, don't worry about it. He said, that's, those things, those aren't lost, he said. Okay. He said, all of those things can come to us again the same way they came before through ceremony and all of that. So he said, because that person had to put them away, and it appears they're lost. Those teachings and all that stuff are not lost. Really made my heart feel good to understand that.
Several times at my lodge, we've had people who are traveling and just felt compelled to pull over and didn't know why, but just they pulled over and they went out into the woods and they found bundles, or they dream about bundles. Three times bundles have come back to our lodge that had been safe, hidden away, that have been returned to our lodge. So they do come back.
Yeah, okay. Some do. Yeah. So, wow. Yeah, it's pretty heavy when you think about it.
Yeah, it was something I was going to ask was, you know, if you're not able to speak your language that's been beaten out of you, then how do you pass on your stories? What's your traditional way of passing on stories within your Anishinaabeg people? What was your traditional way of passing on stories?
So, sometimes when I dream, sometimes the dream is in the language, and I only know a few random phrases and stuff, but my spirit knows the language. And when I dream, I understand what's being said, even though I'm not speaking it and I don't know. I know my spirit knows what they're saying to me in the dream. And not every dream's like that, but those special dreams, my spirit knows the language and I understand what they're saying to me. And as far as lodge goes, you just keep on going, you keep on learning, you keep on trying to learn your language, and you know, whatever you bring back, you pass on.
That's interesting, because you spoke earlier about the always being opposites, two sides, good and evil, for one of a better term, yeah. I can't think of right now. And I was just thinking, we hear about and we know about historical trauma, but you've just shown the other side of historical trauma. Not only is there the whole historical trauma, but there's also the spirit knowledge of the dreams, which is the other side to that.
Yeah, and I've heard it referred to as genetic memory.
Mm.
Blood memory.
You know, and it made some of these things, because I had mentioned before a little bit, at a point where I was struggling in my spirituality and wondering, you know, what is real, and you know, is this things that people just want to hope can happen, and I, you know, I didn't have much to give me direction, and it turned out where I really started finding it was, if anybody's ever heard of the longest walk, you know, there's been, I think, about four longest walks in this country, which all originated from the takeover at Alcatraz, and when the first longest walk took off from there and went on into Washington, D.C., I quit my job and caught up and went on that walk, and this was at a time when I was struggling with my spirituality, and on that walk I started participating in once I caught up in ceremonies in the evenings and stuff. But what I saw that really was visually strong to me was the fact that, and this was way back in the 70s when the McGeezy, the Eagles, weren't very there weren't that many of them around like they are today. And there was a pair of eagles that started off with the walkway in the Rocky Mountains and stayed and followed the walk all the way into Washington, D.C. So they would come around about every day and circle the walk. And so those eagles stayed with it. That, to me, was a start of a understanding about some things that are stronger and more powerful than what we can understand, and started awakening my spirituality to what could be and what is possible, and the strength of the things that we've, our ceremonies have talked about for a long time. And so that was a great moment in my life, was that walk, because, and I think it probably was for anybody that went on the walk, I'm sure it was a great time of pride in being who we were and striving to make a good change.
For me, when we talked about living in two worlds, I'm a biologist, environmental biologist. I am an Ojibwe and Odawakwe woman of the Martin clan, and I do a lot of reading for work, and it's funny when I read these scientific articles where they say copper vessels actually purify the water. We've known this our whole lives, that copper purifies our water. That's what we use for our water. I read that, what was the other one? That there is a genetic link to memory, and that's what we talked about, blood memory. When I was in my early 30s, one of my first trips to go into ceremonies, I had a couple of people in the front seat who were very frequent attendees of the Three Fires Midday Wewin Lodge, which is just over the border into Wisconsin near Bad River. And they were talking back and forth. I'm sitting eagerly in the back seat trying to soak everything up. And they started talking to me about something. And it was the weirdest thing. I filled up with this sensation of light and goosebumps beyond explanation. I mean, I was so excited, like I've never been excited in my life. And I knew I had heard this story before, but at the same time, I knew I'd never heard this story before. And that excitement just made me feel like I was filled up with light, and I had a hard time putting it into words and trying to wrap my mind around what was going through my mind. And when I finally was able to put it into words to these two, they started laughing. I'm like, why are you laughing at me? What is going on? Then they both just said, blood memory. Remember we told you about blood memory? You just experienced blood memory. You knew something. You recognized something that you knew you've never heard in your physical life, but yet your spirit knew. That's blood memory. They said, you just experienced blood memory. And it was such an amazing, I will never, ever forget that pure joy, that pure light was just exploding out of me. I was so excited. It was like seeing someone that you lost and had never thought you'd see again. It was just an overwhelming excitement. But yet, my physical mind's like, but you never heard this before. But yet, my soul knew it. And it was such an amazing explosion. And they just laughed. They're like, yeah, that was blood memory. So anyway, it does exist.
That's an amazing, amazing story. And, I think I've pretty much exhausted all I can think of to ask. I know there's 1,000 more questions that are probably out there, and we'll do this again sometime. And we should do this again and again and again, because more and more people need to see this. And but I don't know if you have anything final you would like to add at all, Hank?
Let me See if you get something, I'll see if I can come up with something profound.
I don't know. You know, laughter heals. We try to do a lot of laughter in what we do, and we're a very loving, laughing people. One of the things the Creator has told us is time is not ours, so try to understand if we show up for meetings and we're not on time. The Creator has told us that time is not for us to worry about. So when we say Indian time, it's because we were told time is not for us to worry about. So we do our best to get there, and I feel a little funny when I show up early. I usually wait outside and not early. But I appreciate everybody listening and trying to keep an open mind, and sorry to have kept you so long. I appreciate that people are open.
Yeah, and I guess I can't come up with anything real profound. I just kind of go back to that, to what you were talking about, is, you know, what people could do if they were trying. And I guess really for me, the thing is to spend some time educating about the people of the native people of your region, and you know, and then spend time with your children to educate them so that they can come into the world and have a good base of the people around them. Maybe it'll help them understand the new people that are coming in also. Don't be afraid.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, guys, thank you so, so much for sitting down and spending your Saturday evening talking about these things, some of which we shouldn't even have to talk about.
Well, we do. We keep, like we all talk, we keep trying. So, you know, if there's somebody out there that's listening and care, then I tell you, me gwetch for the bottom of my heart, because some of you folks are the ones that's going to really make the changes. Because like I was saying, we've been talking about this for a long time, and there are people listening though. So that it's been talked about in our prophecies that they would come back to us and start asking them, what can we do? And you ask the question. So,
and our prophecy says it's the non-native race that's going to make, they're the technology race. They're the ones who are going to make that fatal decision. Do they keep going forward with technology, or do they decide not to take that road? We're here to support you, to teach, to try to educate, to, just because you know how to do it doesn't mean you should. And, you know, all we can do is keep trying to reach out to those who have that open mind. And if it makes a difference with one person, that's one more person.
That made me think of, you know, I often thought, why did we not, as people, want, you know, why didn't we build cars, skyscrapers, things like that? And I thought, you know, did we not have the brains to do that? And then I got really thinking about it. I thought, man, you know, we got the brains. It's just that we didn't need it. We had everything we needed here.
We were happy.
We had all the teachings that kept order. We had everything. If you needed it, you know where to go out in the woods to get it. You can make a new one. It breaks, boom, go out and make another one, because you knew how to do it. And then you also knew how to do it respectfully. So anyhow, I think that's great, and I appreciate that, man.
Well, thank you again, guys, and miigwech.
And thanks.